Hi there, I'm Jeremy Krug and welcome to my 10-minute review of Unit 3 in AP Chemistry, which covers intermolecular forces and properties. Please hit that thumbs up button, subscribe to my channel, leave a comment, and share this video with your friends. Let's get started.
All molecules exhibit London dispersion forces. Usually these are the weakest intermolecular forces, but in large molecules they can sometimes be even stronger than other forces. For nonpolar molecules, these are the only intermolecular force present. The more electrons a molecule has, the more polarizable the molecule is, and the stronger its dispersion forces. Polar molecules exhibit dipole-dipole forces upon each other. The positive pole of one molecule attracts the negative pole of its neighbors. These forces are usually stronger than dispersion forces. Any molecule that contains a hydrogen atom bonded to an oxygen, fluorine, or nitrogen atom will exhibit hydrogen bonding. Hydrogen bonding is an especially strong type of intermolecular force. For all intermolecular forces, the stronger the attraction, the higher the boiling point and melting point of the compound. London dispersion forces are usually the weakest, then dipole-dipole, and hydrogen bonds are strongest. Different types of solids have different properties. Ionic solids have high melting points due to the strong attractions between oppositely charged ions. They're also brittle and conduct electricity when dissolved in water. Covalent network solids, such as diamond and silicon dioxide and graphite, have some of the strongest covalent forces out there. Each atom is bonded to multiple other atoms in multiple directions, making these extremely strong. Molecular solids have individual molecules as units, so that makes them different from ionic solids or covalent network. Sugar is a good example. These have relatively weak forces between molecules and relatively low melting points. Metallic solids include pure metals as well as alloys. Metals are malleable and ductile, and they conduct electricity well because of a metallic core surrounded by a sea of electrons. True solids are crystalline in structure. Some materials are solids, but not completely crystalline. We call these amorphous solids. These include materials like plastics and other semi-solid materials with a non-crystalline structure. The particles in a solid are usually very close to each other, and molecules have the least freedom of motion, with only vibrational motion. In a liquid, molecules are usually a little farther apart so they can slip and slide around each other. That's why a liquid can flow. In a gas, molecules are moving independently of each other and are very far apart from each other. Only gases can truly be compressed or can expand to fill a container. Be able to use the ideal gas law, PV equals NRT. Pressure is in atmospheres, volume is in liters, N is the number of moles of gas, and T is the temperature in kelvins. R is the universal gas constant, which is equal to 0.08206 liter atmospheres per mole kelvin. With the constant and three of the four variables, you can solve for the unknown. When there's a mixture of gases, the partial pressures of the individual gases add up to the total pressure in the container. And to determine the partial pressure of any one gas, just multiply the mole fraction that gas occupies in the container by the total pressure. Also, be able to recognize the graphical relationships between pressure, volume, temperature, and number of moles of gas. Those graphs look a lot like this. Now, temperature is a measure of the average kinetic energy of the molecules in a sample. So if two different materials have the same temperature, their molecules have the same average kinetic energy. If one molecule has a higher temperature, its molecules have a higher average kinetic energy. A graph like this Boltzmann distribution helps us visualize the range of motion in molecules at different temperatures. No matter the temperature, some molecules are moving faster and some slower. At higher temperatures, a greater fraction of particles are moving faster. Now, the ideal gas law truly only works for ideal gases. Ideal gases have no intermolecular attractions, and their particles take up no space. Of course, there is no such thing as an ideal gas in the real world, but some gases do get fairly close. Gases that have little interparticle attraction and a very small molecular size, like helium, approximate ideal gases. Gases normally approximate ideal conditions the best when they're at high temperatures and low pressures, which are the conditions that bring about the least interactions between particles. There are two types of mixtures. Heterogeneous mixtures are those where you can see the different components with your eyes. Homogeneous mixtures are those where all the components are distributed uniformly, and they're more commonly called solutions. Make sure that you can comfortably work with molarity, which is the most common way to talk about solution concentration. Molarity equals moles of solute divided by liters of solution. To calculate the moles of solute in a solution, just rearrange the equation and multiply molarity by liters. Diagrams representing the relative concentrations of components in a solution can be helpful for describing what's in the solution. When drawing a diagram like this, first of all, pay close attention to the mole ratios. In this diagram, it looks like two of the aluminum atoms disappeared. So that means they reacted. So going on the mole ratios, that means we should lose 6 silver ions of the 8 here, leaving just 2 on the product side. This tells us that we gain 2 aluminum atoms along with 6 silver atoms. Now finally, check the states. Anything that's a solid should be drawn clumped together like this, while ions are aqueous and should be swimming around in the solution. There are two primary ways to separate solutions into components in AP Chem. Distillation takes advantage of the fact that different substances have different boiling points. So you can boil the mixture, and the different components will boil away at different temperatures. You can collect the steam and condense the components into different containers, like you see in this diagram. Now, chromatography involves allowing a mixture to pass through a column. Some of the components adhere more strongly to the column, so they pass through it more slowly. Other components, like the blue here, don't adhere as well to the column, so they pass through more quickly. The column itself is sometimes called the stationary phase, and the substances that pass through the column are called the mobile phase. Sometimes you're asked if a compound will dissolve into another compound. Now, if you don't have a straightforward solubility rule to follow, just remember the rule of thumb, like dissolves like. Generally speaking, polar molecules tend to dissolve into polar solvents, often through hydrogen bonding or dipole-dipole forces. On the other hand, nonpolar molecules tend to dissolve into nonpolar solvents. Different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum do different things to molecules. For example, ultraviolet or visible light can cause an atom's electrons to transition to different energy levels. If you see the phrase infrared radiation in the question, it likely wants you to realize that the molecule is undergoing vibrations at those frequencies. And finally, if the question mentions microwave radiation, you need to associate that with rotation of molecules. Light has a dual nature. It can act as a wave, and it can act as a packet of light, which we call a photon. And we can calculate the energy of these photons of light. Use the equation C equals lambda nu, where C is the speed of light, 3 times 10 to the 8th meters per second, lambda is the wavelength in meters, and nu is the frequency in hertz. Now, if you know the wavelength or the frequency, you can figure out the other one. We can use the equation E equals h nu to calculate the energy of a photon. E is the energy of that photon. H is Planck's constant, which is 6.62 times 10 to the negative 34th joule seconds. And nu is the frequency. If you're given wavelength, you'll need to use both equations, but it's a fairly simple calculation. When we work with spectrophotometry in the lab, we use the Beer-Lambert Law. Often written A equals epsilon BC. The A is absorbance, which is a value that we normally read right off the spectrophotometer. Epsilon is the molar absorptivity, which is dependent on the substance and the wavelength. B is the path length, or the width of the cuvette, usually that's 1 centimeter, and C is the concentration of the sample in moles per liter. Since epsilon and B are usually held constant in an experiment, we can plot concentration on the x-axis and absorbance on the y-axis for our known concentrations. You build a calibration curve and use that to determine your unknown concentration like this. If you have outliers on your calibration curve, there's usually a reason. If you have a dot that's too high, it probably got contaminated with a more concentrated solution. If the dot is too low, it probably got diluted with a more dilute solution, or very likely with water when you were trying to clean out the cuvette.
That was Unit 3. I'm Jeremy Krug. Join me next time for my 10-minute review of Unit 4 so we can review some more AP Chemistry together.